Here is the church. Here is the steeple. Open the doors. We are the people.
I can reach any goal today. I can do what I want. I can be what I want to be.
Thank you for that wonderful reception. Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'm Tom Kunkel, and if you can believe it, I am the president of St. Norbert College. And I want to welcome all of you, extend a special welcome to all of you, especially those of you for visiting from other institutions and other places. Thank you for being here tonight for part of our Bell Hooks week-long residency here at St. Norbert College. So we know just some of the people in the room tonight. We have community partners from nonprofits like the Boys and Girls Club and the Women's Fund to corporations like Humana, Schneider, and Ameriprise. Such schools as University of Wisconsin at Green Bay, at Madison, Oshkosh, Lawrence University, and Carthage College, to name just a few. People have traveled far out of devotion to the speakers, including a professor from Virginia who is teaching a new course on bell hooks next fall, and a facilitator from Iowa for Parker Palmer's organization, the Center for Courage and Renewal. Many are tuning in live stream tonight, including among them the Progressive Librarians Guild from the University of Illinois. The Progressive Librarians Guild. As Garrison Keillor might say, there is no force on earth more awesome than a progressive librarian. So, hello, librarians. We're delighted to have you. And we are delighted to welcome back especially our dear friend, Bell Hooks, for this third residency at St. Norbert. Bell has come to call our own Cassandra Voss Center a sister center to her Bell Hooks Institute at Berea College in Kentucky. It's now my great pleasure to introduce two wonderful colleagues and friends, Dr. Carlin Crowley, director of the Cassandra Voss Center and professor of English and Women and Gender Studies, and Anna Zarnick-Niemeyer, Cassandra Voss Center Assistant Director and alum of the college, who will introduce our guests. Please welcome our own dynamic duo, Carlin and Anna.
Hi, my name is Carlin Crowley. I want to begin by giving a huge shout out to our awesome spin doctor, the actual Dr. Amy Ongiri. Can we give a round of applause? Isn't that a great way to begin a conversation? Otherwise known as DJ Afrikeet, she's the Jill Beck Director of Film Studies and Associate Professor of Film Studies at Lawrence University. And I'm guessing there's some Laurentians in the house tonight, maybe? All right. So welcome to the concluding event of our year-long theme, Delight in the Fight, Disarming Injustice with Humor and Joy. This year, the Cassandra Voss Center has hosted 28 separate speakers and performers, over 3,700 attendees. We talk from folks from an anti-violence double dutch team all the way to a comedian from Saturday Night Live. We were featured on the Today Show's website for our work with the Mulva Library on the Human Library, and Ms. Magazine and Inside Higher Ed for our scholarship on identity.
We wanted to share with you the core values of the Cassandra Voss Center, and if you've been into this space or into our programs, you hear us share these each time. So we have four core values. First of all, we are scholarship-driven, meaning all of our programming is grounded in the field of women's and gender studies and identity studies. Second, we are welcoming of all people, both into the space of the Cassandra Voss Center and around the table and into the conversation. Third, we are innovative, meaning that our programming is meant to delight, intrigue, and be cutting edge. Finally, we are fun. We believe that delight resists tyranny. And when there's joy in the conversation, then people want to be in that conversation. We're going to have a lot of joy tonight together. So a couple of pieces of information for you to know before you get started. Outside, you can purchase books, and there will be a book signing afterwards where y'all can line up against that sidewall, and we'll have it on stage. There's also some free buttons out there, and at the Friends of the Cassandra Voss Center table, there's some Bell Hooks t-shirts, and you can also check out what the other events of the residency both have been, and also tomorrow that we'll have morning prayer with Bell Hooks and a time for mindfulness and reflection in a round table, as well as a class discussion. So we joke, if you like us on Facebook, we'll like you in real life. So this is a social media friendly event, and you can use the hashtag SNCBellHooks16. And hello out there to all of those who are live streaming right now. We know that we have folks from actually all over the world, and especially across the country, who are joining us tonight on their computers and smartphones. So, hi. Also, around you, you'll see staff that are in red shirts like this and in Bell Hooks t-shirts. They're there to help you and to assist you, to sell things to you, and to tell you more about the programs that are here tonight. I want to give a special shout-out to our student staff who have worked tirelessly to make this event and all of our events possible. This is like finals week for them, a big, incredible week together. So Morgan Fessler, Jaquan Greer, Emily Hargarten, Kayla Vu, Anna Thompson, and Keyshawn Henning are around and in this theater together tonight, and we want to thank them publicly. We also want to thank our two sponsors for the evening, Humana, who is here with us tonight, and also those of you from the SNC Colleen Chair of Theology and Philosophy. Without you, we wouldn't be on stage, and so we're really grateful for your sponsorship and also for supporting us and being here tonight.
So let's talk a little bit about the order of the night. Bell Hooks and Parker Palmer will talk until about 8 p.m. Then we'll have about 20 to 30 minutes of Q&A. We'll have mics so you can come up and ask questions. And then we'll do the book signing on stage as mentioned. We wanted to let you know that the Cassandra Voss Center at 311 Grant Street, if you haven't been into the space of the center, it's really lovely. It will be open tomorrow from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. and you can come and hang out anytime you want. Now to introduce Bell Hooks. There are many ways to know Bell Hooks. Perhaps you've come to know her through her transformative feminist theory, beginning with her seminal text, Ain't I a Woman, written when she was 19. Perhaps you've come to know her through her five children's books, which talk about topics from managing anger to embracing boyhood to new ways of loving black hair. Maybe you've come to know Bell Hooks through St. Norbert College, as this is her third year return. It's also year three with the Cassandra Voss Center as a sister center to her own Bell Hooks Institute in Berea, Kentucky. Or maybe you've come to know Bell Hooks through her recent blast of pop cultural references this year, when she had a conversation with Emma Watson, aka Hermione Granger, consulting with the He for She campaign for the United Nations. Maybe you know Bell Hooks through her Saved by the Bell Hooks memes, related to the 1990s television series Saved by the Bell. Maybe you know her through the created Bell Hooks hotline, where if you don't want to give someone your telephone number, you can hand out the fake phone number that texts them back a Bell Hooks quotation. This is what's called a kind of feminist phone intervention and was created by someone else, right, in honor of Bell Hooks. Or maybe you know Bell Hooks, acclaimed theorist and author of 40 books in any of these ways, but today you'll come to know her better because here in this long-anticipated conversation with Parker Palmer, we get to hear her firsthand. Hooks earned her bachelor's degree from Stanford, her MA from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, her PhD at the University of California, Santa Cruz. Her teaching career began in 1976 at the University of Southern California as an English professor. She's since held positions at Yale, the City College of New York, Oberlin, and she is currently distinguished professor in residence in Appalachian Studies at Berea College in Berea, Kentucky.
And now for Parker Palmer. The first day I met Parker J. Palmer was filled with warmth. Warmth because of his connective, hospitable spirit of listening and gratitude, but also warmth because we were at a retreat center near Atlanta, Georgia in December. And for a Wisconsinite in the winter, you all know that's kind of heavenly. I had the privilege of gathering with 30 other young millennials from California to Peru, all accepted for his Courage to Lead for Young Leaders and Activists retreat through his Center for Courage and Renewal. Instead of the typical icebreaker listing our jobs and credentials, Palmer asked, "When do you feel most alive?" For many of us who have read or talked with Palmer, we feel most alive when grappling with the work of Parker J. Palmer himself. Palmer is author of 9 titles who have sold over a million copies and have been translated into 10 languages. Among these books are The Courage to Teach, Let Your Life Speak, The Heart of Higher Education. His latest book, Healing the Heart of Democracy, The Courage to Create a Politics Worthy of the Human Spirit, has been called, quote, one of the most important books of the 20th century for those who care about democracy. Palmer's work is also revered, and he was included in a series called 40 Days With, which also includes folks like Martin Luther and Julian of Norwich. That's pretty good company. Palmer co-founded the Center for Courage and Renewal in 1997 as a resource for those in serving professions, like teachers, doctors, pastors, offering training and time for reflection, decision-making, relationship building, and vocation exploration. To this, I can personally attest, at the Center for Courage and Renewal has become a global resource with facilitators and retreats across the world. Some of you are here tonight, and I know lots of you are watching live streaming tonight. Palmer also spent much of his time in spiritual community at the Quaker Retreat Center, Pendle Hill, where our own Dr. Carlin Crowley also once lived. Palmer holds a PhD in sociology from the University of California at Berkeley, as well as 13 honorary doctorates, 2 Distinguished Achievement Awards from the National Educational Press Association, and an Award of Excellence from the Associated Church Press. In 2010, Palmer was given the William Rainey Harper Award, whose previous recipients include Margaret Mead, Eli Wiesel, and Paulo Freire. In 2011, the Utne Reader named him one of 25 visionaries on its annual list of people who are changing the world. A member of the Religious Society of Friends, Quaker, Dr. Palmer lives just 2 hours away in Madison. Palmer was last at St. Norbert College in 1990, and his talk was an inspiration for St. Norbert College's own first living learning residence hall, housed in Bergstrom. Palmer has been a prophetic voice in higher education for many and is one of the most beloved spiritual writers of our time, in fact, both of our guests tonight. Having Hooks and Palmer here together in conversation is like a dream team come true because of their mutual work on love and mindfulness, particularly in the classroom. Hooks' book, Teaching to Transgress, and Palmer's book, The Courage to Teach, are among the most beloved by educators working on authentic teaching and justice. We are thrilled to welcome Parker J. Palmer tonight in conversation with Bell Hooks.
Well, as part of my excitement for being here with Parker, I have been reading every single one of his books again, and I said, I've been in bed every morning for weeks now with God and Parker Palmer, because after I do my morning meditation and everything in my prayers, I then start reading Parker. Today we mentioned together that conversation is very segregated in our society. There are certain people that never talk to other people outside their class, their race. So it is really exciting to be here talking to Parker Palmer. It's like in Liz Gilbert's new book, The Big Magic, she talks about how ideas are kind of floating in the universe, and that some people have simultaneous ideas that intersect and meet. And it is so very true that when I read Parker, I often feel like I'm staring into a mirror of ideas, because we are so in sync in our thinking about spirituality and teaching. It's exciting to be here with you.
Well, it's wonderful to be here with you, Bill, and with all of you. Thank you so much, and thanks to St. Norbert's and the Cassandra Voss Center. I was thinking when we were talking this afternoon about the importance of conversation, about something that Martin Buber once said that made a huge impact on me. He said, all real living is meeting. All real living is meeting. And I've come to believe that that's deeply true, that it's in live encounters with other people, with nature, with the world of spirit, whatever it may be, in conversations widely understood, that we really live and we really transform. I'm so thrilled with this particular conversation because I feel like we've been in conversation through our books for many years. But the truth of the matter is that every time I wanted to find out if I was on the right track in my writing about education, I'd look at your latest book and see if you quoted me. Then I'd figure, I think I'm doing something right because Bell likes it. And for many of us, it's true. You have been, can I say, bellwether or a litmus test, a kind of plumb line about what needs to be made right in the world of education, in the world of teaching and learning, in the world of social justice and regard for the human soul. And I honor that. I'm so grateful for that. And to have it here live in Technicolor is wonderful.
It's interesting to think about, like with us, why has it taken so long for us to have a meeting place? And it's funny that it's at a historical moment where we really are as a nation in crisis. And I went back to Parker's early book, which I really, really like, In the Company of Strangers, because we all know that we're at a moment in our nation where there is so much xenophobia and hatred and fear of the stranger that is surfacing. And he really talks about the need for us to remember, especially those of us who are Christians, that our vision of hospitality is very much based on welcoming the stranger.
Yeah, I was really touched when you told me this afternoon that The Company of Strangers, which was a 1981 book, had struck you as relevant to today. That means a lot to me. That book, just a quick history. So I finished my PhD at Berkeley in the late 60s. My plan all along had been, I thought, to become a college professor. But by the late 60s, the cities were burning. My heroes had been assassinated. And it seemed to me, someone who really embraces this notion of calling, that we all have a calling in life. It may change from time to time. But there's an inner voice that says, go here, not there, that maybe we don't listen to often enough. It seemed to me that I was called more to work on the streets than in the classroom. So I went to Washington, D.C., and I became a community organizer with a couple of other people. We set up our own organizing institute in a rapidly changing neighborhood called Tacoma Park, East Silver Spring. And I worked there with a coalition of 35 churches, or congregations, I should say, because they were Jewish, Catholic, Seventh-day Adventist, mainline Protestant, a pretty broad slice of religion in that part of the world at that time. And without the base that those congregations provided in that community in the early 80s, in the late 60s and early 70s, 10 years before I wrote the book, we wouldn't have been able to do what we did. What we were attempting to do was to prevent one more round of white flight, as of the sort that had happened in Prince George's County on the other side of the edge of the District of Columbia. We wanted to say to people, look, at some level, you really don't want to run away from otherness again. Because I do believe there's an instinct in the human self to want variety, to want diversity. I mean, on one level, we like being with our own tribe, but on another level, our own tribe is so boring. And the air gets so stale inside that silo or inside that cocoon. And there's a desire to fling open the windows and breathe fresh air. And so we said, one of the things we think you're learning, speaking to people in the community, is there's no place left to run. I mean, we live in a diverse world, and the idea that you can run away from diversity is nonsensical. And so let us instead turn the lens the other way and ask about the richness of diversity, the variety of viewpoints, the new understanding that it can bring to us, and even more fundamentally, let us start to have the experience of feeling more at home in our own skin and on the face of the earth by being comfortable in the presence of otherness. And all of that is the gift of hospitality. And I'm 77 years old, and I think every now and then about my mortality, more than I did when I was 37. And I can't imagine a sadder way to die than with the sense that I'm still not at home in this body, right? And I'm still not at home with the bodies around me. And, you know, one of the ways in which your work has been so edifying for me is with this emphasis on body. And I think that translates to me into very concrete feelings of, am I at home in my own skin, and am I at home with the skin of other people or not? Because if I'm not, I've got some work to do. And that work is about opening my heart, opening my mind, moving my body toward a live encounter, toward creative engagement. All real meeting is living.
Well, when you were talking, I was thinking about immigration, and one of the things Daniel Berrigan says is the bridge of illusion has to be destroyed in order for a real bridge to be constructed. And to me, you were speaking to the reality that we are in diversity. There is no escape. And it seems to me that the sort of growing seeds of fascism in our society, most embodied right now by the voice of Donald Trump, is the denial of that reality and the attempt to use immigration as a way of acting as though we can be pure. We can be inhabit a world where everyone is like us. And of course, everything about our lives is telling us that's no longer possible.
Yeah, exactly. I'm a great believer in reality. You know,
me too.
the transcendentalist Margaret Fuller is reputed to have said, "I accept the universe," and I think it was Emerson who said, "By God, she'd better." I sort of feel like it's at that level of reality that we have to come to terms with who we are and where we are, and we are in diversity. The purity theme, the purity motif, is an evil mythology.
All right.
And it always leads to evil. What does that word even mean when we understand from the human genome all the kinds of mixing and matching that have gone on in the course of history? I think it was John Oliver who pointed out that Mr. Trump started out as Mr. Drumpf, D-R-U-M-P-F. There's diversity right there. I mean, let's just, you know, get a grip on it. And I want to name as a very serious issue, which I share with you, the seeds of fascism that were planted a long time ago in this society.
Yes.
Around which we now see some flowering. And let me be very definitional and very specific, because I don't want this to be heard as gratuitous name-calling. It's actually a category, a term of art in political science that we're talking about. One of the primary marks of the leader of a would-be fascist movement is that he does not need a plan to solve anybody's problems. All he needs is a scapegoat on whom to blame those problems. And then a very strong bluff that becomes a promise that he will eliminate that scapegoat, a blustering promise that he will eliminate that scapegoat. I think that's an accurate technical definition of what leadership, would-be leadership of a fascist movement looks like. And I'm hoping that reminds some people of some things going on at this very moment in our society. Do I feel badly about the number of Americans who have lost their jobs and lost their homes. Of course I do. I feel incredible empathy with them, and I don't think it's possible to wake up in the morning happy in this country thinking about all the people who are suffering from that and a million other ills. But do I think that building a wall between us and Mexico, where since 2009 more Mexicans have left this country than have come in, will help those people get their jobs or homes back? Of course I don't. That's insanity. Do I think that preventing members of a religious group, by definition, from immigrating to this country will help them get their jobs or homes back or make us any safer? I do not. Since 9/11, there have been 42 radical Islamic murders committed in this country. There have been 47 murders committed by right-wing Christian authoritarian fascists. Who are we to be more worried about if you take statistics seriously? I mean, there has to be a call to sanity in the midst of all of this. And do we want to solve those problems? Of course we do. But we don't want to settle for the bogus solutions that feed evil.
That's why healing the heart of democracy, I think, is so important. I have been talking a lot about democracy and how, when I was growing up, and I'm 10 years younger than Parker, there was in our schools a constant discussion of democracy and citizenship and what it means to be a citizen. And I always participated in the Voice of Democracy contest, and it was a time for critical reflection on, for young children, and to reflect on our role in democracy and being citizens. And it seems to me, Parker, that that's a discourse that's completely left the public schools.
Yeah, it has, hasn't it? I bet there's a bunch of public school teachers in the audience tonight, and I think they could pretty quickly tell us one of the big things that's driven this out of the classroom. And that's this nonsensical emphasis on high-stakes testing, so that anything that can't be measured in a sort of micrometer way doesn't get taught anymore. And that includes art and music and a lot of things that humanize education. I have a kid who was saved, who was failing at school. He was saved by a pottery teacher who revealed his natural gift for pottery. Making pottery and getting good grades in that course gave him self-confidence as a human being. That started translating into success in other parts of school. And today, that son of mine heads up an HIV/AIDS research center at the University of Colorado Medical Center in Denver because he's a PhD microbiologist, thanks to a pottery teacher in a high school in St. Cloud, Minnesota.
Yes.
So we are playing a very high-risk game when we pretend that these tests and the scores that come out on them have anything to do with educating a child who has potential. There's a John Dewey story that I'll take just a quick moment to tell because I want it emblazoned on the American consciousness about the shell game that testing is. In John Dewey's day, it was the IQ test that was creating a lot of classist and racist divisions because the test was geared so that certain kinds of people would succeed and others would be regarded as dumb. So John Dewey was asked one day, "What do you think about the IQ test?" He thought for a minute and he said, "Well, it kind of reminds me of life out on the farm." He said, "I remember my dad would go out there, set up a big old balance scale with a big piece of plywood on one side and a piece of plywood on the other, and he'd put a hog that he was going to take to market on one side, one piece of that plywood, and then with my help, he'd start stacking up bricks on the other side until the two were perfectly level. And then we'd try to figure out how much those bricks weighed. Think about it. That's testing. Nobody knows how much the bricks weigh. It's an illusion, and it's hurting a lot of teachers and a lot of kids, and it's driving unmeasurable but critically important kinds of discourse, like citizenship discourse, out of our public schools.
Well, both you and I have been truly committed in our lives to education as the practice of freedom, and we just celebrated National Library Week, and as I was doing my taxes and having to write big fat checks, I said, gee, I wish I could be writing these checks to the public library, because it is because of the public library that in the world of racial apartheid and segregation, I was able to learn about so many different worlds. So I encourage all of us to use the public library to remember how important it is. I mean, one thing that Parker writes about so beautifully is public space. And think about it, where are the spaces that we can come together with strangers or with difference? And when I was growing up in my racially segregated town in Kentucky, the library was one of the places. It was almost like a sacred place. You could, you know, go to the public library and you could be with people of different ages. And it's interesting about domination and racism, because the librarians, no matter what they really thought about race, were just so eager to have you be a reader and to think. And so some of my early affirmations for learning came from librarians.
And there's, what is it, the progressive librarians in the audience tonight? Where are you folks? Oh, they're live streaming. Hi to the progressive librarians.
I know.
I think that's a redundancy, though. I mean, aren't just librarians, are progressive.
So that I think that, how do you feel, Parker, in terms of our work to encourage people really to teach for wholeness? I mean, you often evoke Merton's The Hidden Wholeness. And I often find that other intellectuals make fun of the idea of wholeness. Like, Bell, you really think there's some kind of thing called wholeness and healing? And, of course, you and I both feel very strongly that learning is a place of healing.
Well, absolutely. And, you know, you can't believe in what you can't in what you haven't experienced. So I understand where some people are coming from when they scoff at the idea of wholeness. They haven't experienced it, so they can't believe in it. There is a certain level at which, if we haven't been able to receive a gift for ourselves, it's impossible to give it to another person. So educators who have not received the gift of wholeness for themselves can't hand it on to their students. That just doesn't work. You can hand on the solution of a math problem, or you can hand on a body of sociological data or some historical facts or a theory in physics, but you can't hand on those personal intangibles which you have not received as gift in your own right. And some people are blocked by that, and academic formation or deformation is, I think, infamous for blocking that gift in people. It took me a long time to recover from my doctoral program and regain my humanity.
Absolutely.
Because the whole purpose, and I'm quite serious about this, the whole purpose of the doctoral program was to disappear the self, right? To disappear the self so that I could become the bearer of objects of knowledge that I could hand to my students as if they had been untouched by human hands, right? That's the purity motif at work again. And again, it's evil, and again, it's demonic. So here's my operating definition of wholeness, which puts it within reach for me. Wholeness is not about perfection. Wholeness is about embracing my brokenness as an integral part of my life. When I can do that, I can stop worrying about being perfect. Am I perfect? No. No way. I shouldn't go too autobiographical there. The therapists will all run up on stage and try to help me.
But you say that, you know, the best therapy is the union of personal problems with reaching out to a larger world.
Right. Well, you know, your work, Bell, around, you know this so much better than I do, but the whole feminist movement, and certainly your representation of it, has been a movement from saying to women, as we did 50, 70, 80 years ago, maybe still sometimes do in some places, these feelings you're having, these issues you're having, they're all intrapersonal, and they're mainly suited for the therapist's office, you know, some sort of psychoanalysis. But in your generation, along come a bunch of women saying, no, wait a minute, this is about a social condition that is impinging on the wholeness of a whole lot of women, that's making them think of their brokenness not as part of their wholeness, but as some kind of pathology. And what we need to do is get political about it. We need to address the social, cultural, and political conditions that are causing these feelings in women, and some resonance in men as well. This is not women's issues alone. Problems for all of us, problems for the quality of our society. So that ultimately therapy is both personal and political.
But I think also that the challenge to patriarchy as one of the systems in our culture of domination has been so threatening to people, so threatening to many men. I talked last night about the tremendous misogyny that has come out as men express their hatred of Hillary Clinton. Not what they disagree with her politically about, but a kind of fierce anger, which is at heart a real anger at feminism and how it has changed the nature of gender relations in this society. As I was speaking at a library the other night, one of the people asked me if I thought that women were in a different place from men, if men were, and I said, for women, feminism really opened up the possibility of healing, not just from patriarchy, but from all kinds of wounds of trauma and childhood stuff and certainly the challenge to domestic violence. And it seemed like there has not been a parallel push for men as a whole to go inside, even with Daniel Goleman's work on emotional intelligence. There doesn't seem to be a kind of equivalent space where men in our society are moving forward.
I agree with that, and I suffer from it to some extent in the work I do, because as a man, I would love to see more men join us in this work that we do through the Center for Courage and Renewal of rejoining soul and role. And incidentally, when you just used the phrase emotional intelligence, I thought, how interesting that we had to translate this into emotional intelligence.
Yes.
To make it acceptable to men.
Yes.
Rather than just say, let's talk about our feelings, you know. But, no, let's talk about emotional intelligence because we have some data on that, you know, and we've got brain scans we can show you guys and where the brain lights up and there are wires involved and machines, you know. This is like you can do it in your garage, you know. So the revolution needs to carry on. I'd like to say a personal word that I've actually been, ever since you invited me to do this, which really touched my heart, I've been thinking about the struggle I've had with patriarchy in the worlds that I've wanted to work in. Because very early on, for reasons I don't understand, I was a male person who wanted to do his work from the heart and not just from the head. I wanted to talk about whole sight, about, to quote a 19th century Russian Orthodox theologian, I didn't want to just talk about thinking. I wanted to talk about thinking with the mind descended into the heart. You know, thinking not from the tower where you're lording it over everybody, but thinking it from this center place in the human self, remembering that the
Papa, heart, where did that desire come from in you?
Well, see, that's what I don't know. But what I do know, I really can't trace that, except my dad, who was a Chicago businessman who never got any farther than a high school diploma. I was the first in my family to go to college. So I was lucky in that I didn't have any big model of what a learned life was supposed to look like, you know. How did I know you weren't supposed to think from your heart? Nobody ever told me that or modeled anything different. And my dad was a man with a big heart as well as a fine mind. So what I do know is that when I started, you know, wanting to write and talk about spirituality in higher education, it was like they didn't want to invite me to the party, right? So I was smart enough to, and I'll give away the secret now of how you do this stuff, for all the younger people who are looking for a way to get the camel's nose under the tent in whatever field you care about. I realized, oh, I can't talk about spirituality in higher education, but I can talk about epistemology, because it's a big word, and I practiced spelling it so that I could, and I even read some stuff about it so I could tell them about something that they should have been thinking about but hadn't been thinking about. And since epistemology is the foundation stone of all teaching and learning, from every epistemology comes a particular kind of pedagogy, and from every pedagogy comes a particular kind of ethic or way of being in the world. I could trace that logic chain, bring them along, and take them to the same heart place about who we are in the world as educated people, as if I had tried to open the door with the word spirituality, which they would have slammed in my face. Translate, use language to build bridges, not walls. I think that's the takeaway message. But I also wanted to be a man who could write about, eventually, and talk about his three deep descents into clinical depression, not as case studies in human pathology, but as schools of the spirit that I've been to in my life. The deep darkness where you aren't just lost in the dark, but you feel like you've become the dark, because they've been so powerfully formative for me. And when you have a devastating experience which has you on the edge of wondering, should I take my life today or not, because there's nothing vaguely resembling life going on for me, and you manage by some unknown alchemy to survive that experience, you want to make meaning of it by offering it up to other people in some way. Because you begin to realize how many people in this country and in this world suffer from that, or how many people stand close to someone who is suffering from that.
And especially men. Partner.
And especially men. The best book that I know about male depression is called I Don't Want to Talk About It. So there we are back on that motif again. Well, so it hasn't always been easy for me to go public with themes like that. But here's the other thing I know, and this is where I think gender considerations become very important if you keep turning the prism. It's a lot easier for me to go public with my three deep dives into depression than it would be for a woman. In fact, let's just be frank, I become a hero for doing that. A woman becomes a goat. She can't be trusted with this responsibility. Remember, however, I grew up at a time, or I was a young man at a time, when someone named Thomas Eagleton was kicked off George McGovern's presidential ticket as the vice presidential candidate because it was discovered that he had been treated for depression. It was tragic that this model was held up to young men my age. if you go there, don't tell anybody about it or your career is over. So I did have some walls to push through, but I remember once some years ago talking to a big convention of doctors and saying, I'm going to talk about my depression and how physicians did and did not help me with it, because some of them are not helpful at all. But I said, don't worry about me, because I understand that having a history of depression renders me ineligible for the vice presidency of the United States, which is huge. I mean, that's great. You know, what better gifts could I have? I'm safe. No one will ever ask me to do that. And what a god-awful job that would be, you know. So it has its bennies.
I mean, I think that as we have a revised feminist movement, we will begin to see how much patriarchy oppresses men. Next year in our residency, and we're going to talk here at St. Norbert's about masculinity, because the weight of patriarchy produces mental illness in men. It produces a world of disordered desire. And we start on that with boys. We're not a boy-loving culture. We are immediately inviting boys into the space of violence, especially in the public school. I'm all for homeschooling boys for that reason. Both Parker and I are very much anti-violence. And I think we're definitely seeing a time in our culture where violence is almost being celebrated.
Yeah, for me, Belle, the working definition of violence, and I know this is true for you too, goes far beyond striking someone or shooting someone or dropping a bomb on someone. I've always understood it as any way we have of violating the integrity of another person. And if you start to think about violence that way, as any way one has of violating the integrity of another person, you start to see violence all around you. And it certainly is in our schools.
And shaming is one of those tools of violence that is particularly directed at males. Mm-hmm. You're not strong enough. You're a wuss because you have feelings.
Yeah.
You shouldn't cry.
Yeah.
All of those kinds of things. And not a lot has changed in our culture about that. It's interesting to think that there have been so many changes for individual adult men. But when we look on the level of boys, we don't see a lot of change in how we're thinking about boys and raising boys. I've been thinking a lot for some reason, because we've had all this struggle in Kentucky around the Confederate flag in the small town that I live in, about, you know, just even thinking about the Civil War, which was such a brutal war, where so many young males lost their lives. And you think about, why do people want to celebrate that war? You know, we have all these sort of Civil War reenactments. And I think, what a peculiar thing that people don't refer to the sort of massive death of young men that were part of that war.
750,000 Americans killed each other in the Civil War.
It's amazing, isn't it? And we have all these suburban enclaves that have the battlement, the battleground. I was telling Parker that I, in my institute, I've been publishing pamphlets, and I fund my institute myself, so I'm hoping all of you will run out there and grab the recent pamphlet that I did with Cornell West. But I've done a pamphlet with James Hillman, who came to Kentucky so we could walk many of the battlefields and look at the graveyards as he was preparing to write his book on war. And it seems to me that fundamental to democracy has to be going against war.
Yeah, I agree. And I know you and I would agree on this too, that begins with me or begins with you. I think there's a confessional mode in any of this effort to move toward social change that begins with, in Quaker language, trying to uproot the seeds of violence in my own heart,
yes,
in my own soul. I can get started talking about the current presidential campaign, or parts of it, and start to feel pretty violent inside pretty quickly. And that's a seed of violence that I have a choice about. Am I going to feed that seed? Am I going to nurture it? Am I going to spread it around like an invasive species? Or am I going to find some other way to look at that and say, I need to get right with God, to use a quick version of what's a much larger issue. I need to get right with the next person that I meet who holds an oppositional viewpoint to my own politically. I'm really working on this proposition, and this is a nonviolent notion, that it's more important to be in right relationship than it is to be right. And I'm really working on what are some of the skillful means of getting into right relationship with people around political conflicts that can turn violent. I want to be very clear. I don't mean that we are going to, that I'm going to give up, or that I'm urging anyone to give up on right versus wrong, fact versus fiction. Those are important questions to be sorted out. But they're also complicated questions. And if we don't create containers called right relationships where we can stay in dialogue about them, how will we ever get them sorted out? Now, some people hear me talk about this, and I've talked about it a lot in recent years, and they say, well, that's idealistic. And I'll say, look, I will grant you that 20% of the people on the left and 20% of the people on the right don't have the capacity to enter into the kind of conversation that I'm reaching for here. But that leaves 60% in the middle who do. And in a democracy, that's more than enough to do business. And there's evidence that this actually works. I have a dozen stories. I won't tell them all right now, but a dozen stories about the evidential base that people can come into right relationship to each other around oppositional viewpoints. And it often involves, and here we come back to the territory that you've walked so beautifully and articulated so beautifully, it comes back to storytelling.
Well, I was thinking about that, Parker, because I was thinking about how, and I encourage all of you to read all his works from beginning to where he is now, thinking about how I could see the evolution in you, in the work, the thinking more deeply about race and gender, each year of a book or what have you, so that I think that sense of reflection, I mean, because we both believe deeply in contemplation and reflection as part of healing and wholeness, that one needs to be able to be still and to be able to hear and listen to the self.
Exactly. And you've been one of the people who've helped me think more deeply. That's one of the values of conversation, even when it can't be face-to-face. We've had conversations in our books, and you've had conversations with people I've never met, conversations with people I can't meet because they're dead 100 years or 200 years. I didn't discover Thomas Merton until the year after he died, but I've never stopped talking to the guy, you know.
Well, you write about circles of trust, and I write about radical openness, because I think that part of being able to be with people that are different from yourself, who think differently, is that sense of being open, which for me does go back to hospitality. I mean, one of the things I like about my otherwise feudal state that I live in, Kentucky, is that it always emphasized growing up civility and courtesy to the stranger, to those you know. And I recognize now in these older years of my life how much civility is about openness, of willing to think beyond the self. Which is very hard in our narcissistic culture. Both Parker and I are writing about social media and both its exciting interventions, but also it's scary. As I sometimes see little kids, you know, so engrossed in the game or whatever it is that's before them. They can't say hello. They can't talk. And I think, who will this person be at 16? Who will this person be at 20? How will they locate the heart's yearnings or their desires, their vocation?
Yeah. If you can't have that conversation with yourself or another person, how will they do that? So I think those reflective dimensions of our lives are really, really critical. What we do in our circles of trust, for whatever it's worth, and I think this is a form of radical openness, we have some ground rules. I'm not going to go into all of them, but there's one that I think often interests people that help create a trustworthy space. And I'm talking now about the work of the Center for Courage and Renewal, and about which I wrote about in a book called A Hidden Wholeness. So when we gather a cohort of 25 K-12 teachers or 25 physicians or clergy or nonprofit leaders, and we start a two-year journey through 8 retreats of 3 days each under facilitation the whole time, we say, for the next 2 years, at every one of these 8 three-day retreats, we're going to follow a very simple ground rule. No fixing, no saving, no advising, and no correcting each other. No fixing, no saving, no advising, and no correcting each other. And there's always someone in the group who almost leaps out of their seat and screams, "Well, what in heaven's name are we going to do for the next 2 years? You've just taken away the only things we know how to do." And that's true. If you listen in on the average conversation where one person brings a problem or a concern to another, I always say, well, we give them about 3 minutes of listening. Or if we've been to a listening workshop in the last month, 5 minutes. And then we start either fixing, saving, advising, or correcting them, you know. You take that away and you create a space where people have to listen, because they can't be sitting there thinking about how they're going to solve this person's problem, which is nonsense to begin with, because the only solutions that count are the ones that come up from within us. And so instead of fixing, saving, advising, or correcting, what we learn to do in these circles of trust is to ask each other honest, open questions about what we're saying. And it turns out that asking an honest, open question is a high art in our culture, especially those of us who are academically trained. We've been trained to ask questions that are little speeches or advices in disguise. So I always say to people, "Have you thought about seeing a therapist?" is not an honest, open question, right? Not at all. But if you say to someone, if you're listening openly and you say to someone, "Well, has anything like this ever happened to you before?" That's likely to be an honest, open question, because you're not sitting there thinking, "I know the right answer to this question and I sure hope you give it to me." And if they say yes, well, could you tell a little bit of that story? And if they tell a little bit of that story, as you hear yourself talk about that, is there anything in there that you feel like applies to your current situation? Do you see what I'm, to your current situation? This creates trust, because what the human soul wants more than anything else is not to be fixed, saved, advised, or corrected. It wants to be witnessed. It wants to be heard. It wants a deep bow.
And I think that as you were talking about listening, I was thinking about how crucial listening is to the practice of love, and that the practice of love allows us then to engage in community because we are able to listen. So on that note, we want to thank you all for listening to us. I want to thank Parker for teaching me and for allowing me to hear his stories and to grow from them. So we'll open it up for questions.
Thank you, Bill, so much.
And we'll hold a mic for you, and then we'll hear from our speakers.
Say your name, if you will.
Oh, my name is Ned. I teach at one of the only progressive schools, public schools in the state of Wisconsin here in Green Bay, Aldo Leopold, and I'm very lucky to do so. I brought a book, it's The Courage to Teach, that a progressive librarian lent to me 15 years ago when I was an undergrad at St. Olaf College in Minnesota. So I brought it so maybe I could return it to her at some point, and maybe even with an autograph tonight. My question for you, you talked about violence and violating the integrity of another person, and I think that we haven't quite discovered maybe a nonviolent way to manage the classroom atmosphere. And I feel like there's a struggle with that, even with those of us who want to not violate the integrity of our students. How do we create more of a peaceful environment, and respect that integrity in our students?
Well, thank you for your story about the book. I went to Carleton, but even though you went to St. Olaf, I'll sign the book. It's all right. So peace is possible in the world. And thank you for being a teacher. The first thing I have to say about myself is when people say, so you're a pacifist, and I say, no, I aspire to be nonviolent. I ain't there yet. I'm a great believer in the idea that God ain't finished with any of us yet, certainly not with me. But I know what aspirations I want to hold that I want to draw me forward, and so that I try to do that. Second thing I want to say is that kids come to the classroom, and you know this better than I because this is your work day in and day out. Even in a progressive school, they come with enormous pressures on their lives, expectations that are either real or that they're projecting about how they must succeed at this or that, or at very least not fail. They have voices telling them, find a direction and find it soon. They have voices telling them, get strong, arm yourself, because this is a tough world. And I want to create a space where they can bring forth the thing I talk about a lot in The Courage to Teach, which is their fears, in a way that also allows me to share my fears, so that instead of our fears not being named and claimed and thus multiplying on each other in a classroom situation, which inevitably creates psychological or spiritual violence. And teachers have a great fear of what I call the judgment of the young. I don't think the average group of 20-year-olds understands what it's like for a 77-year-old guy, even though he has lots of degrees and lots of awards, to stand up in front of a group of young people who look like they are terminally bored with him. I have a 25-year-old granddaughter who had a teacher that I revere, and he said to his class at the end of the first session, you people have got to learn facial management. He said, you may be bored, but don't look like it, or you're going to get punished for it. And if you stop looking bored, maybe you'll get less bored, and maybe I'll become a better teacher who won't bore you. That's a little joke, but it's true. It happened. What I really want to do is unpack our fears in a way that reduces that level of violence so that we can get on with the exciting business of teaching and learning that always involves risk, but without the kind of fear that shuts us down.
Shall we go over here for a question?
Hi, I'm a student here at St. Norbert, and I honestly didn't know either of you before. I didn't know Bell Hooks before yesterday. I'm upset at myself that I haven't, and it's been an honor to listen to you guys. conversate today. And my question is, you guys touched on like media and technology a little bit, but what role do you see media and technology playing in trying to overcome like the ignorance of diversity in our world today?
That's a great question. That's an old teacher trick, right?
I'm unable to answer that question because I do very little with social media. I don't use the internet. I wouldn't know how to send an email. So I'm going to have to turn to Parker.
So I have this qualification right here. Bill asked me what that was, and I'll explain it to her. So I don't think I have any special wisdom around that, except to repeat what I think has been wisely said. On the one hand, the internet, used improperly, can be a source and a constant reinforcement of ignorance at a depth that we've rarely seen in the civilized world, right? And we see evidence of that around us every day. Barack Obama was born in Kenya and is a Muslim because there are 110,000 websites where it says so, right? And every time I go to Breitbart or wherever, they send me to those websites. There's behind that is a very fundamental flaw in that person's education, which is about learning to learn from diverse sources and to discriminate amongst, the wheat, to separate the wheat from the chaff. We have a university system in this state where we talk about sifting and winnowing, right? I know there was a desire in certain quarters to remove that language from the charter of the university and make it about job training, but that was we all know that was just a clerical error, right? That was adequately explained, certainly to my satisfaction. You see how pacifistic I'm trying to be? So you also see how snarky I can be. So the great potential of the internet is to give ordinary people a chance without having to drive a long way and know how to use a library in all of its technical depths, to actually do some checking and correcting of sources and to read a diversity of sources and to find out what sources are more reliable than others, partly by asking people that they trust and coming to their own conclusions about things, never freezing on those conclusions because tomorrow you may read something that upsets your apple cart and you always need to be open to that. So on that level, I think we have a long way to go before we'll know what the net effect of the internet is. The second thing that strikes me really comes from your generation and the millennial generation, and that is the power of the internet in organizing people for social action. There are a number of pretty compelling stories about how people have used that technology to come together around meaningful causes in ways that couldn't have been done in my generation. I spent a lot of the 60s in Berkeley, both participating in and witnessing the student movement, the free speech movement, and so forth. And there was a lot of misinformation floating around that took a lot of time to sort out. And had we had a technology that allowed for faster and more accurate communication, I think it might have helped. It's hard to say.
Well, we should move on with our questions in order to get everybody.
I'm Brenda Waring, and I'm president of the school board for Green Bay Area Public Schools. And I guess, Dr. Hooks, I wanted to ask you to elaborate a little bit on a comment that you made, because it was a little bit concerning to me. I think the comment you made, and I won't quote you exactly because I can't remember exactly, but something about how public schools are a place where we're encouraging violence in boys. And I guess my concern is on a number of levels with that. I think if you expand the definition of violence, I would argue that it's not just boys, that it's there's you know, people's lives are being infected in very negative ways, both boys and girls. And then also the fact that you specifically mentioned public schools. And to me, public schools are where our children have an incredible opportunity to experience otherness. And I just hate to hear public schools being stated as something that's in a negative way. And I just wanted to have, I don't think that's what you meant, and I want to have you just elaborate a little bit on that.
Well, I don't really feel like I have an elaboration. I think that I wasn't giving an overall assessment of public schools. I was really thinking about the role of patriarchy in our school systems, because where do people learn their gender roles? Where do people learn aspects of thinking that to be a boy is to be violent? So I do think that a lot of that learning takes place in schools. But I don't have more to add to that. Your name?
Thank you. It's a quick thank you to both of you. My heart has grown three sizes tonight, so I appreciate this. Quick question for Belle. How do I inspire men to embrace feminism when sometimes my anger and my sadness for our plight can get in the way and block the clear message?
Well, I think that, you know, Pema Chodron, Buddhist teacher, says start where you are. I think that we have to hear what men are saying, first of all. We have to be willing to listen to what men are saying their needs are or their pain. I feel like there is a lot of pain in males in our society, and I do think that feminist thinking can be a source of healing for that pain. Unpacking, I mean, Parker had something that he was stating about childhood in one of his books, and who we are as children before all of the stuff is imposed on us. And I think it's especially helpful for males to be able to get in touch with themselves as boys. I mean, that's why I started writing children's books, and why I wrote the book B-Boy Buzz, to think about, again, a wholeness for boys, to be able to play, to laugh, but also to be able to sit still. I think that as we educate with males, I do a lot of workshops around love, and there'll be gender separation. And when I go to the one for women, we have so much to say about love. Then I go to the one for men, and men will say, I don't think about love, or I don't know what to say about love. My father never said he loved me. And so I think that, again, it's in those conversations that men begin to be able to trust and let go, to say what they feel. And I think that one of the ways we can help anyone is to give men the tools, the books, all the things that can help people to learn. And then sometimes, you know, I've been witnessing to my brother. I figure I was witnessing to him in the womb, and he's still a jerk. And he's still caught up in patriarchy. But I have hope for him. You know, as we witness together, it's both about spiritual life and about ending patriarchal thinking. Because he, as he approaches being closer to 70, begins to articulate some of that pain. Don't you think it's interesting that so many men begin to open their hearts as they are approaching their 70s, or as they are really realizing that they're not going to be on this earth forever? And this is it. This is the moment. I was always amazed at how the patriarchal terrorist that was my dad began to shift and change with his aging, and to begin to open up to a level of tenderness that was not there for most of our lives with him.
I'd like to just add one thing that loops us also back to the, I think, an important question about boys in the schools. which is the patriarchy in public schools. I think the first people that it wounds are the teachers. And I know how much you believe in politics. I do too. I know how much you believe in joining the personal and the political. I do too. I think the politics we need around public education right now is a politics that liberates teachers to be teachers. I know their hearts. I know their hearts. My organization has worked with teachers since the early 90s, tens of thousands of teachers all around this country in these circles of trust. And I know why they're there. They want to help kids grow, and they want to do it one by one by one, depending on the circumstances of that child's life. They're there because they love kids. And we have a patriarchal politics that is coming down on teachers with draconian requirements that are absolutely irrelevant to educating a child, but have everything to do with creating the illusion that we're doing something educational. And that's got to stop. Let's have a politics that liberates teachers to be teachers. I'll run on that platform.
Hi, I'm Ben. I teach here at St. Norbert. And a constant topic conversation here is the future of higher education. Inspired by your visit today, I picked up Three Guineas by Virginia Woolf. And a question that never occurs or hasn't occurred in any of the conversations I've been a part of is a question that Woolf asks in that book, which is, what would a college that would end war, systematic violence look like? That's something that we don't really think about when we think about the future of St. Norbert. And the answer she gives is also interesting, I think, because you all both talk about the hidden curriculum a lot, where she talks about what it would actually physically look like, where there would be no more grand old buildings, it would be rickety shacks, you know, put up by the students and burned down after they graduate. So I was wondering what you thought that, you know...
That happened at Berkeley, incidentally. So
what do you think, if you were to say, what does the new adventurous college of the future look like such that it would help end systematic violence, capitalist, white supremacist, patriarchy, etc.?
Well, I mean, I think the main thing is teaching people again how to be in the practice of love. Because everywhere I go, I see that people who love do not have the will to dominate or to do violence. So if we thought about what it would mean to have schools that would start with examining how we love, how do we know what love is, and to be able to have that, there is no one formula because each school would have to grow out of its local experience and what. But I think that love, teaching love as the starting point, is the way to teach without violence and to bring a peaceful sense of learning.
Yeah, it's a huge question, and I certainly agree with what Bell just said. To me, if you begin with love of learning and love of learners as ends in themselves, learning and learners as ends in themselves, that's the right starting point. And unfortunately, most higher education, most pre-college and university education, gets off to the wrong on the wrong foot with that one. We don't treat learning or learners as ends in themselves. We treat learning as a means to the end of getting a job. And we treat learners as a means to the end of providing what the society needs to fill its slots, right? We commodify learning and we commodify learners. So I really think before we get to what the buildings ought to look like or what the curriculum ought to look like or what the faculty and students ought to look like, we have a massive piece of cultural transformation to work on, at least in pockets. I'm a great believer in pockets of possibility. Most social change doesn't happen across the board. The civil rights movement, the black liberation movement of the mid-20th century, probably involved a maximum of 5% of the American population in any way that might be called active. And yet it accomplished significant things legally and institutionally, and to some extent culturally, although that's obviously an ongoing battle and will always be. But still, those pockets of possibility are important. And that's where I would begin. How do we sit with one another in a way that says we are learning as an end in itself, and you as learners are ends in yourself? We're here for no other reason than to make each other into real human beings.
Your name?
Hi. Thank you. My name is Sam, and I'm just a student here. Something you said earlier really struck me. You said it's more important to be right in a relationship than it is to be right. And I'm wondering what the best way you think would be to go about that, to break down the sort of egocentric barrier that's either innately put in front of us or societally built. And what do you think the implications of that would be if people started, stop trying to burn down the bridges by just being right and trying to form more genuine connections with others by being right in a relationship?
Yeah, so it's more important to be in right relationship than to be right, and to unpack that a little. Well, you know, I think Bell grounds a lot of what she is reaching for here in love, and I think she's absolutely right. And I think one of the concrete marks of love is genuine interest in the other person. Like, who are you? What is your story? Where did you come from? I want to know you better. This is not, we're not just two talking heads here. We're two human beings, and that means we have story upon story upon story. That means we are rooted in not just one community, but multiple communities. That means we have relationships that are important to us. That means we have fears that wake us up at 3 a.m. That means we have hopes and dreams. If I have genuine interest in the other person, that's a powerful form of love. If I can start there and then take that to a question about your story. So, you have just told me that you hold belief X around this political issue that happened to be the opening topic of our discussion. Help me understand where that comes from on your life journey. Help me understand why you believe what you believe in terms of a story that comes from your experience that will bring that belief down from a level of abstraction where we're breathing very thin air and hurling ideas at each other like weapons, down to a place where we can hear stories that are recognizable in terms of our own shared humanity. And then let me tell you a story. And as we do that, we start to sort out. We may not agree with each other politically, but we leave that conversation knowing we can talk again, knowing we have not blown up one more relationship in a society that is already so fragmented that it looks like and is a kind of war zone. I don't know how much time I've got.
Well, we need to listen to these questions. Your name?
I can tell you later a story, okay?
I'm Maggie, and I'm a pre-service teacher, and I'd like to go back to what you were talking about, both with healing and violence. Disproportionately in college and increasingly in high school, young women and men have that wholeness taken away from them during a sexual assault. And I'm wondering, what comments or recommendations can you make to administrators or college communities in general to avoid re-victimizing survivors during the reporting process or that period of healing?
I don't have an answer for that.
I don't have a policy answer. I think You know, I think we'd have to look at a particular case and ask what was or wasn't done. And I think probably at the moment we don't have time for that. Here's what I want to say to institutional leaders, however, in general, that bears on this and a lot of related issues. I want to say that our institutions generally are in a period of decline and increasing dysfunction. And part of that is because too many leaders of institutions have bought into what I call the logic of institutions, which is all about self-protection, self-preservation, and self-promotion. Okay. The example that comes quickly to hand, of course, that everybody knows and understands, is pedophilia in the Roman Catholic Church and other church traditions, and the long demonstrated record of the offenders being protected by higher-ups who wanted to engage in the self-protection, the self-preservation, and the self-promotion of the institution, even though the lives of our precious children were at stake. And it's taken a long time for this to come out, and it's taken courageous action on the part of those who have been gravely wounded, action that any one of us would find enormously difficult to take, and they've done it with very little support and often with a lot of blowback from the people from whom they were simply asking for truth and honesty. That's got to stop. And I'm not just talking about one church or one institution. I'm talking about the same dynamic in colleges that have so badly mishandled cases of sexual assault. We can't let this get out. We can't let the victim be credible. Who knows what it might do to our major donors or our next round of fundraising or the report that's going to go in the higher education press. That's intolerable, and we need a generation of institutional leaders who understand that it's intolerable and who think in a completely different way about what it means to head an institution from a different set of standards than those of self-promotion, self-preservation, and self-protection. I think those standards are available. I think they're called the standards of faithfulness and service to the highest values of the professions in which we serve.
My name is Elissa. I'm a student here. You both work in a place where you face social injustices every day, and sometimes seeing those social injustices and working with them can start to weigh a person down, and I was wondering what keeps you driven and motivated to keep working for change?
For me, it's spiritual practice. It's a belief in justice, and certainly it's that constant renewal of spiritual hope.
Yeah, I would say that, plus a couple of other things. I would say, first of all, I've learned to love being disillusioned. And I want to put this out as a challenge to the audience. So somebody comes to us and says, oh, I'm so disillusioned by what's happening in this area that I care about. And we put our arms around their shoulders and we say, I'm so sorry, let me comfort you. We should say, congratulations, that means you've lost another illusion. Right? And that means you're that much closer to reality. Tell me, how can I disillusion you more? Because I'm the guy to do it, you know? So I like to take these experiences of disillusionment and say, I'm now closer to reality. I'm now closer to the truth. And reality is where I can get some traction. The other thing is this, and this may sound flip, but I mean it very seriously. People say, Parker, how can you be hopeful about, for example, democracy in a time like this? And I say, well, that's easy. It keeps me employed. I get to do things like with bell hooks and audiences at St. Norbert's because I'm hopeful. But I'm quite serious about staying employed. And I don't mean making a living. I mean, if I turn cynical and sour and just throw my hands up and say, a pox on all your houses, as far as I can tell, that leaves me with little option except to pull up a chair to the corner of my dining room, sit facing the corner, sucking my thumb, and thinking dark thoughts for the rest of my life. And that sucks. I mean, that just totally sucks. And I don't want to be that kind of old man, you know? So I'm hopeful. It keeps me employed.
So, yes.
My name is Joe Lovis, and I'm a student here. You both have discussed about how having relationships with people and having open discussions are a way towards improving upon our situation and trying to eliminate the patriarchy and this culture of dominance that we have. My question is, have either of you attempted to open an invitation for hospitality and dialogue with those that are advocates for violence or advocates for this culture of dominance that are trying to promote the flowering of fascism in this country?
Well, you know, I start with the premise that there's some of that in all of us.
Yeah.
Racism is everywhere. Sexism is everywhere. The tendency toward violence is everywhere. And so I don't feel like I have to reach too far to find that. I don't have to reach any farther than myself, truly, to do what I call rooting out the seeds of violence, or at least attempting to do so. In our circles of trust, which we now have 300 facilitators working over the last 20 years around this country and around the world with tens of thousands, probably 100,000 people by now, in the serving professions, these issues come up all the time. People who want to blow up their institutions, teachers who are convinced that the reason they're having trouble as teachers is because of all of those children of color in their classroom. And we deal with that constantly. But we deal with it in a way that challenges people to grow from the inside out. You know, there are stages of life where you need an ethical exoskeleton, right? You need to be propped up like a puppet by strings that are attached to ethical standards. But if you live your life that way, it's not going to work. The strings are going to break, and you're going to start flailing around and doing damage. So it's the endoskeleton, it's the ethical endoskeleton that grows up from the inside that I'm interested in, and that our circles of trust attempt to evoke from people. And so we're constantly dealing with these issues of differences. Now, there's selectivity in who comes to us. I'm trying to think of an example. Is a white supremacist who's publicly identified as such and famous in the press as such going to come to one of our circles? No. But does white supremacy show up in our circles? Yes, because it's endemic. It's not the possession of a handful of people. And so when you open your eyes, it's around you all the time. I was in a conversation the other day, and I spread this just as a message from another voice, about 14 graduate students in a sustainability program. There were three African-American women there, probably all of these students in their 30s and 40s. And some of the white students got to talking about how shocked they are that around the Trump campaign have gathered these white supremacist groups, you know, who variously try to keep a low profile and then raise the flag because they want some notoriety out of this. And one of the African-American women, after listening to this for a while, she said, you know, I have to tell you that my friends and I are watching with amusement as white people find themselves shocked at white supremacy popping up in our country. We've been watching that for umpteen generations. it comes as no surprise to us. And I think it was a huge wake-up moment for that whole class. And suddenly the conversation shifted to how can we use this moment of the boil being lanced, as it were, in a way that white people can see it, towards some constructive end. That would be an example of what I'm talking about. You don't have to reach far to find what you're looking for, I think.
Okay, so early on, y'all were talking about all real living is meeting, feeling comfortable in the presence of others, moving the mind past that discomfort if it's there. And there's power in connection, and there's something foundational about that relationship building when you're challenging these sort of dominant and dominating structures. I do want to acknowledge that there's a legitimate fear and discomfort that comes from the reality of our context. As a queer woman of color coming from Chicago, I can't say that I was totally comfortable driving into northern Wisconsin. And I'm not totally comfortable saying that right now. And I don't want to minimize that discomfort by just saying, moving my mind past that. And I don't mean to suggest that y'all are minimizing my discomfort. I know you're not. So I want to ask, how can I connect? How do I connect? How do I feel comfort in the presence of others in my context when, I guess, the things that foster that discomfort and foster that fear are not just in my mind, but also in my physical space and in my lived experience?
Well, I think that... I don't think any of us should feel comfort in dealing with any kind of aggression, assault, dangerous situation. The question is, how can we handle productively being in such a situation? So I would say it's actually moving away from notions of comfort to notions of intervention. I often say to people that I think of dealing with someone who is being racist towards me or sexist as how do I throw the ball back to them so that they work with the situation that they created rather than me feeling that I have to handle it.
Right. And in the work that I do, I'm very aware that there are circles in which I ought not to be present because I pose a danger, a perceived danger, no matter how hard I may be trying to be safe. And so I work with a community of people, and we make decisions about who should facilitate this conversation, who should facilitate this circle, what are the qualifications for being in this circle in the first place. And we think very carefully about that in certain circumstances where it's not just a random collection of K through 12 teachers that we're dealing with, but it's a group of people who've gathered for a special purpose. And there are many other occasions when I simply need to be the listener, the witness, and not the speaker. But there is one thing I would like to say just out of my own story that is about an early seed of sensibility that was planted in me. My dad, whom I revered, was a businessman in Chicago. And I was born on the south side of Chicago. After a few years, my parents moved to the suburbs. It's an old story. It was in Chicago in those days. I was a teenager, and my dad took me back to the south side neighborhood where I had been born and spent the first few years of my life. And as we left, he said, "How did it feel walking around that neighborhood?" And I said, "It felt scary, Dad," because I was growing up in a homogeneous white community, and the neighborhood where I was born had become mostly people of color. And all my dad ever wanted from me was honest expression of, you know, feeling and experience, and I said, "It felt scary." So he didn't say much more, but a few weeks later, we were on Michigan Avenue. His office was at 725 North Michigan Avenue, which is a pretty nice part of Chicago, right, as conventionally defined. And not far from where we were standing was the YMCA College, which my dad was related to as a board member. And there were a group of African-American young men gathering on the sidewalk to go into that college for their classes. And my dad said, "Do you see those young men over there gathering to go into the Y here on glittering Michigan Avenue?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Do you remember how you felt when you were back on the South Side where you were born and lived for the first few years?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Those young men are just as scared to be up here on North Michigan Avenue as you were to be down in that neighborhood where you were born." He just wanted to plant in me a seed of understanding that what feels safe to one person doesn't feel safe to another, and that I had a lot of thinking to do, which I'm still trying to do with questions like yours, around what's my role in this or that situation where we're trying to establish safety.
So we will close on that note. We thank you all. We thank St. Norbert.
If you wish to get things signed, we have some, obviously, books to buy, and we can line up, and our esteemed speakers will sign for us. Thank you.